So thank you very much for inviting me here. For me, it's a big honor to speak after two amazing speakers and two of the most beautiful brain in Portugal and, in, of course, in Germany. So science is very, very interesting. So Martina told me that I should have been a little bit fun to explain what I do and what we do in our laboratory, but I mean, it's very difficult to be fun about cancer, right? Because when you speak about cancer, it's really, really very difficult to find this this side of the spectrum. It's still the first cause of death in the West world, so we are really struggling a lot to find a cure for several type of cancer. So what I'm going to show today is a novel approach of for treating cancer, so different type of cancer, which is called pro-senescence therapy for cancer, that we have developed in the laboratory of Pierpaolo Pardolfi while I was at Harvard Medical School, and that we think could offer really a potential novel therapeutic opportunity for cancer in general. So I will try also to be a little bit more fun to explain how the invention that we published during the year were made from in the lab of Pierpaolo Pandolfi, which is one of the biggest labs in the United States in cancer biology. I will come also to what we are doing now currently in my lab that unfortunately is not a lab with 150 people or 35 people, but it's just a lab of 6 people. Unfortunately, this is due to the fact that in Switzerland we have to pay a lot of for them to stay, so the salary are very, very high. But we are going to do better. So let me first explain what is cellular senescence. So unfortunately, all the people know that we age, and the reason why we age is because a cell can go to replication during the lifespan, and after a certain number of replication, which Aflick defined in 60 replication, a cell stop to grow, and this arrest is an irreversible arrest, which is called senescence. Even if I take this cell, which is in the arrest, and I try to manipulate genetically, this cell cannot re-enter in the cell cycle. So by definition, senescence is a irreversible cell cycle arrest. So this type of senescence is called replicative senescence, right? So it's due to the fact that the telomere, which are extremities that encapsulate the DNA, gets short after each replication, and what's happening is that DNA damage gets accumulated in the cell. When this DNA damage is too much, cells stuck, and they cannot re-enter in the cycle. So what we discovered when we went in the lab of Pierpaolo is that even oncogene and paradoxically loss of tumor suppressor gene can do the same. So you know that an oncogene induces proliferation, right? That's why it's bad for cancer. And even loss of a tumor suppressor gene do the same. But when you do it this in vitro, what's happened is after initial replicative phase, the cells stop to grow and arrest irreversibly. This type of senescence is called premature senescence because which can happen really, really very fast. So we don't have to wait 60 splitting in vitro to get this senescence, but it happened like in 5-6 days. Okay? Another way to induce this premature senescence is to treat cell with DNA damage agents such as UV radiation or X-ray radiation with chemotherapy, for instance, and also culturing the cell in suboptimal growth condition. So why this is important for cancer, this is first slide, a cartoon that show you the difference between a cell, which is a normal cell, which has nucleus, which is small, which is very elongated. On the contrary, here on the right, a cell which has a nucleus, which is big, which the cell is flat, and more importantly, staying positive for this marker, which is called beta-galactosidases. Beta-galactosidases, it's an whole marker of senescence, but there are additional markers that we have to check before to say that a cell is a definite senescent cell. So why this is important for cancer? It's because in 2005 in the lab of Pierpaolo we show for the first time that this response, which we were observing essentially in aging people or in vitro after manipulation of oncogene or loss of tumor suppression, was also happening in vivo. So it was a very, very important discovery that, by the way, was done from a technician in the lab of Pierpaolo, Zhenbang Chen, that was a plant biologist, just to explain to the people that want to go to United States, stay to be in Italy, where the career is very, very slow. So this guy now is a professor in Texas, so it's actually, I think, associate professor, and he came as a technician, he stayed 5 years, and published a beautiful Nature paper as first author, and an additional paper, and now he's completely independent, he has his group, he's doing something different. So what Zembang discovered, what was surprising, is that if we remove P10, which is a tumor suppressor gene, which is very important in prostate cancer, what we observe paradoxically, it's an upregulation on another gene, which is called P53, which is a master regulator of senescence, and this was able to restrict the development of a tumor. And I show you here what Zembang discovered, what we also discover later in this field. So in other words, this is the effect of a genetic inactivation of P53 in a prostate epithelia of a mouse. So these are genetically modified mice, so in which we remove one gene, which is called P53, nothing happened, even though this gene is very, very important in cancer. On the contrary, what's happened when we remove the two allele of this tumor suppressor gene, which is called P10, we get a tumor, which is quite big. This is an MRI in mouse, actually. It's the same machine that we use for patient. But surprisingly, when we combine this inactivation with this other inactivation, the tumor became extremely invasive, big, and killed the animal because essentially it's invade the intestine and metastasize, so it's really a big difference. So what we were able to show is that the difference between this tumor here and this tumor here, which is only lacking the P53 allele, is that this tumor here contains a lot of cells which are senescent cells, so they are beta-gal positive cell, and that if we lose this blue cell by genetically inactivating P53, this tumor lose the blue cell, of course, and became extremely aggressive, like this tumor here. So when I joined the lab, and I was the only oncologist that was going to a lab that is very tough, where people study genetic manipulation, and actually I didn't know. So the reason why I joined the lab was also, as Pierpaolo always say, I was very lucky. I just went on the web page of Memorial Sloan Kettering. I had a lot of clinical publication, and he selected me, even also because I have my own money. So from that moment, I understood that if you want to do science, you have to be like a person that is able even to take money, to transfer this money, multiply this money, give to the other people. And so that was the first time in my life that I understood. So the reason why he took me in the lab was because I was a good guy, also with some money to go to abroad in the United States. So so since I was the only oncologist there, I said, okay, but this is cool. So can we enhance the senescence response? Can we use this for cancer therapy? Pierpaolo said, oh my God, it's a very good idea. For me, it's very simple to think, right? So what we later show in 2010, that before to understand how to enhance this senescence response, we should have understood how it's regulated. So in this paper that we published last year, we showed that there are essential genes which are important for this senescence response. For instance, that this gene here, which is called ARF, which is a master regulator of other type of senescence response, in this specific type of senescence response, which we name PIGS, it's not so important. And also, with our surprise, we discovered this other gene, which is called TOR, that is also an anti-senescence gene, so it's an anti-aging gene, was able to drive the upregulation of P53, so this senescence response was dependent strongly by the activation of TOR. What is fun about this discovery is that we, together with Pierpaolo, we patent a beautiful patent, which is the base of a spin-off company that I have, but is not involved in that, which want to make anti-aging cream from these compounds here, which block TOR, that we discover is able to block the senescence response. So we have an idea. We said, okay, let's make an anti-aging cream, right? If this block this senescence response, perhaps it block also other type of senescence, like the aging type of senescence. So we are trying now to formulate this compound here in a cream formulation, just to try to see if it's working. By the way, in the Harvard Medical School, they use also this compound now. They published two Nature papers showing that this compound is able to prolong the survival of mice when you give it just in the water. And the prolongation of survival of these mice is really, really very, very, very long. So just to tell you that from discovering cancer, you can end up to discover also something important for aging and to do something important for us, for the society. So let me introduce P10, which is the master regulator of this response. So P10 is a phosphatase, which is very high in the PI3K-AKT pathway cascade. PI3K-AKT pathway cascade is one of the main regulators of cancer. And so this is P10. So if we delete P10, as happened in cancer, what's happened, there is an accumulation of this lipid, which is called PIP3. It was discovered from Lucantli many years ago. And this end up to be the first lipid to be able to signal to a protein, so to AKT, which is a powerful oncogen. So in other words, when I remove P10, I get proliferation, survival, so resistance to stimuli, such as apoptosis. And also, I remove P10, I get migration. So cell can migrate more. So P10 is really, really important. Indeed, we know that P10 is deleted in the majority of glioblastoma, lymphoma, and in prostate cancer. So in Switzerland, we have studied specifically P10 in prostate cancer pathogenesis and therapeutics. So this is a slide from William Gerald Lab, has long gathering that showed that this pathway is really one of the major dysregulated pathway in cancer. And we study essentially this regulator extensively. So what we published, which is very complex also to explain, but which is also very beautiful, I just spoke before with the president of the university. He said that he was intrigued by a recent discovery from Pierpaolo, is that the biology is very, very complex, and that even as shown in this paper that I published in 2010, if you downregulate the expression of a gene from 100% to 80%, so you just touch the expression, downregulating the expression of the gene of 20%, the mouse can develop a tumor. So if you drop the dose of this gene, going from 80% to 50%, the tumor gets even more invasive. There are new phenotypes that show up in, for instance, in this mouse, there is breast cancer, but the mouse does not develop prostate cancer. On the contrary, if I drop the dose of P10 of 50%, I got different type of tumor. So this is the first paper that showed that even if you don't touch the genetic information, so if you don't have mutation in one allele of a tumor suppressor gene or deletion, just by downregulating the expression of this tumor suppressor gene, you can get cancer. And what the people now is doing in the field is to try to understand if this RNA variation that affect also gene that Pierpaolo recently discovered, such as pseudogene, perhaps are the cause why we get cancer. And as you know, we have a limited number of genes, but the expression of this can be much, much complex, and Pierpaolo is trying to discover this. So why I show you this? Because it's so complex. What we show is that if I drop the dose of P10 or 20%, I get tumor. If I go to 50%, I got even more increased big tumor. But if I drop it to zero, paradoxically, we have a senescence response. So this was a big demonstration that the dosage is really, really very, very, very relevant. And so just